What's happening, guys? Welcome back to Sliced. Two things before we start. Firstly, it might seem if you only watch me on YouTube that I only post like, what, two or three times a month? Actually, not the case. I post almost every single day. You just have to follow me on my socials, at @sliced_yt, Instagram, Twitter, TikTok. I post all the time. Secondly, I've actually started virtual cooking classes. I'll put some details up here just so that you can kind of pause it and see if you're interested. It'll be really fun and it's open to anyone, any skill level, any age, gender, whatsoever. Just send me a message on Instagram or Twitter or whatever and I'll get to you. With that being said, let's get into today's video. There seems to be two extremes in the mind of the average home cook, right? On one side, you have food that is plated at home, which pretty much looks like the Eat Well plate. It's literally just split up into carbs, protein, all your veggies and stuff like that. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. That's just fine to eat. On the other extreme, you kind of see these really minimalistic, fine dining, tiny plate, sort of really over the top fancy kind of plating styles that you generally associate with fine dining, and it kind of seems really pretentious or really sort of technical and hard to reach. But I'm here today to show you that we can actually achieve really simple, beautiful looking plates without having to break the bank and by using very simple ingredients and equipments that many of you will be able to find. Equipment. Anyway, if you want to be able to plate food well, you have to start from the bottom and work your way out. Firstly, what is the ingredient you're going to cook? We're going to look at the base ingredient. In my case, it's a king oyster mushroom. If you've never tasted one before, they're a really great meaty kind of mushroom. They have an amazing texture and they can hold a really beautiful glaze and golden color that looks perfect on a plate. And that's going to be my basis for this dish. From our central ingredient, we can build around it. Firstly, what are the ingredients that are going to go around it? No one wants to see a plate with 500 ingredients on it, trust me. So we're just going to keep it limited. Try and keep it to around 6-7 max kind of things on the plate. You don't want to have too much going on. So with that in mind, let's start building this. Firstly, what plate are we going to use? At home, generally, you'll just have simple standard white plates. That's absolutely fine. But you might end up figuring out, look, the colors that I'm using might work better on this plate. Might not even work well in the plate. You might want to use a bowl instead. It absolutely depends. From then on, I generally like to pair my main ingredient with a puree. Purees are not essential at all to plating, but especially if you're starting off, it acts as a very great foundation to start building your canvas on. I'm making two purees here that I'm going with my dish. One is a pea puree. This is going to be the main puree. So what I'm going to do is briefly cook some frozen peas in some boiling salted water, just enough that it's cooked through. You really want that green to show through. I'm going to chuck a lot in a blender and I'm going to blend it really, really well until it's an incredible smooth paste. You can add tiny bits of water if you need to, but you really want to be left with a thick sort of paste by the end of it. You can pass it through a sieve if you notice any lumps, otherwise you can just put it straight into a squeezy bottle, piping bag, or even just a pot and you can use a spoon to plate it. The second puree I'm going with, and this is not going to be the main puree because it's got quite a strong flavour, I don't want it to overpower the dish, but it will go well when it comes to colour. This is a carrot puree. It's very simple what I've done here. Just peel some carrots, wash them, chuck them in a pot with about 3 parts water, 1 part orange juice, just to bring out that sweetness, that color. Giving it a little salt and bringing that up to the boil so the carrots are tender. Same thing again, blending it and putting that into a squeezy bottle. Those are gonna be my two colors. And as you can see, those two colors are very different. If everything on your plate is green, it's gonna be muted. You're not gonna really be able to tell what's going on. If everything on your plate is brown, you know, you can't really pick out those individual components. You really want to be able to see what's on the plate. It should look visually appealing. So with that being said, let's start off with a very simple style of plating, a circular type of plating. The best advice I ever got for circular plating is actually to draw an imaginary circle within the plate. And this brings us on to another key point of plating. You want to leave negative space. One of the reasons why piled up plates don't look incredibly desirable is because, well, all you're seeing is food. There's no empty spaces. There's no sort of like, you're not really raising it on a platform, do you know what I mean? You really want to sort of imagine the plate as a canvas and create negative space, which will really allow the food to shine. Negative space does not mean putting a tiny bit of food on it, it just means knowing the area that you're working within and making it look really attractive. Now with that imaginary circle in mind, I'm going to start by building this plate up. So I'm going to put some pea puree as a base, and you can use a number of different ways. I'm just going to sort of smooth it out into a rough circle. You can create a spiral effect. You can even do a swoosh if you'd like, just keeping it within that boundary of the circle. It's absolutely fine. And then I have my mushrooms, and I've just simply cooked these in a bit of oil, butter, salt, pepper, a bit of herbs and garlic, that kind of thing, similar to how you'd cook a steak or some chicken. But what's the point of just having these two ingredients? We obviously need a garnish to build around this. Now, when you're thinking of a garnish, we're thinking of flavors that pair well with the mushroom. We're also looking at trying to incorporate different textures and things that will allow us to build height on the dish. One of the worst things you can have is a flat dish. So let's start building this together. Firstly, I've got these lovely baby carrots with the stem still on. I'm gonna give them a nice clean, peel them carefully, trying to keep that shape intact. I'm just gonna cook that down nice and gently in some butter, adding in a tiny bit of orange juice, salt and pepper as well, just sort of glazing that, creating a sort of emulsion, making those carrots look really nice and glazed. I might wanna sort of cut them in half just so that I can angle them in the right way and build height against the mushroom. As another simple garnish, what I'm gonna do is take a shallot, taking the root off but keeping that pointy top on. I'm gonna peel the outer layer, and then in a pan with some oil or butter, I'm going to place the shallot face down, giving it a really strong amount of color, almost to the point where it's past golden. You really want it to be dark because, well, you'll see why. We're going to add in some water or stock on top of this and put a lid on top, steaming it. After like 10-15 minutes, you're gonna see that the shallot is fully cooked. We're gonna take it out layer by layer, and you'll start to see that the inner layers have this beautiful effect. They have a really crusted sort of dark edge, and the outside is really nice and cooked. You don't want to put too many of these kind of garnishes on the plate because it will sort of take away. No one just wants to eat a mouthful of shallots, right? You have to be mindful of that too, but a couple of these will look really nice. And so I'm gonna add that as well. As my third sort of garnish, I'm going to be making some Parmesan crisps. This is a really simple chefy kind of technique. You can try it with different hard cheeses, it will work quite nicely. I'm just gonna grate some Parmesan onto a lined baking tray, baking it in the oven, 160, 180, and you wanna take it for as dark as you want it. I want them to be fairly light, so I'm just gonna take it to a pale golden color. When you take it out of the oven, it's gonna be bubbling, it's gonna look quite liquidy. You're just gonna leave it on the side, let it chill out for a bit. It's gonna become nice and hard, and you'll be able to snap beautiful shards off it. And we're gonna use these again to build some beautiful height on our dish. Now, take a look at your plate from afar. Is it missing anything? Can it be built in any different kind of way? I might notice a few negative spaces, and so I'm gonna add some little small dots of the carrot puree just to add a different sort of level of color to help the dish stand out a bit more. Working in odd numbers is a really great way to build a dish. It kind of adds this level of sort of non-perfectness, kind of off-centering things. Finally, to top everything off, it often works really well if you have some kind of micro herbs, micro greens, and that kind of thing. And these are often things when you think about, you're like, how can I ever afford these? I can never find these anywhere. But actually, you can get them fairly simply. I've just taken a bag of watercress that you can get at literally any supermarket, and you look for the tops of the herbs, and that's where the tiny little shoots come out. And I'm just gonna pick these off and put them in some ice cold water so that they can really open up and look really vibrant and beautiful. And I'm gonna dry them and place them on top as well. You can do this with many things. You can do it with mint as well. You'll often find the tiny little mint leaves at the top. Microgreens are really easy to sort of pull out of anywhere. It can really work quite well. And finally, I'm gonna finish everything off with a hollandaise sauce. A good sauce works really well when you're plating. You really want to sort of combine all that texture together with something that brings it all together. I've got a lot of sweetness, I've got a lot of richness going through this dish. I really want to cut it across with a really tart hollandaise sauce. It's going to be really nice. What I'm going to do is drizzle it around the outside, kind of keeping that as my border. You don't want to make the plate too messy. You just want to have a sort of small amount. You can even pour it in a sort of little decorative pool if you'd like. That's absolutely fine as well. Now look, this plate looks like it might take ages to put together, and it probably does. If I was going to serve this, I might not even include every single aspect of the plate. I just wanted to show you a different variety of techniques here. But you should really be looking to make as little movements as possible. There's no point in putting hours into your plate, just take it to someone and the plate's gone cold. No one wants that, right? So work with few movements, trying to put the cold garnish on first if you can, and then putting the hot garnish on right at the end. Normally, if you have like a piece of chicken or fish, something like that, you might want to just put that right at the end, just so that it's nice and piping hot. But with that being said, that's a very simple way of looking at a circular plate. Now, to show you an alternative way of plating, we're going to go for a more linear, kind of asymmetrical effect. In this way, I'm sectioning off my plate, not in a circle, but in strips. And so I'm going to go sort of two-thirds into the plate and draw imaginary lines where I'm going to be doing my plating. I would say this works quite nicely for a starter where you just want to occupy a small amount of space, or even a dessert, whereas the main is sort of better suited to a more circular kind of motion. What I'm going to do, rather than squeezing my pea puree onto the plate, I'm going to put it onto a spoon, hitting it down slightly onto the plate with a little bit of force just to allow it to come off at the top of my plate, and then keeping your spoon on the plate, bringing it straight down to create a lovely line. You can use a tissue and always clean things up, don't worry about it. Very similar garnish to the last one, except this time I'm trying to create more of a length, and so what I'm gonna do is build things long ways. What I might do is cut the mushroom in a slightly different way perhaps. I might, rather than cutting them to halves, might cut them into quarters just so that it can take up more of the length of that plate. You really want the main ingredient to stand out. And then I can fill those negative spaces with the rest of my garnish just like that. Finishing it off, and then this time with the sauce, We can either fill that negative space with the sauce, or I can run it parallel to it, or I can just drizzle it all over the top. That's totally up to you. Look, the main thing is be creative, be confident, and just explore it. I've just sort of shown you the foundations of what you can do. Now that you know that you can afford this, and all these ingredients that I use, what, they would have cost me, what, 10, 15 pounds? If you have guests coming over, you really want to try and impress them, think about it like this, okay? Think about the colors, think about what you can play with, think about the flavor combinations, okay? Try and make it taste good. Try and have the texture, try and have that height, try and build things in a really beautiful way. Think about negative spaces. These are all just principles that I'm trying to show you and a few basic techniques that you can use. But go absolutely crazy. There's no limits to what you can do. Just try it out and I'm sure you can come up with some beautiful, beautiful things. And if it doesn't look right when you first try it, so what? Try again. If you do actually end up trying some techniques or even elevating your plating in a slight way, maybe it might be shaping your rice in a certain way, little things here and there, send me a picture at slice_yt on Instagram. I'd love to share it with everyone else. But with that being said, thank you so much for watching. Please like, subscribe, put your notifications on, follow me on my socials at slice_yt. Check out the cooking lessons if you're interested, and I'll see you next time. Bye.